That'll do.
So we haven't figured out how we're going to get here, but we're going to build the rocket as we go. So if you would like to help out with that,
see Meredith, see Maddie, see Jen, see myself. There are opportunities for the Lord to make this a great time for our kids. Registration will be available in the next few days, so be looking for that on our bulletin board and emails and everything else. Also coming up next Tuesday, the 4th, obviously our offices are going to be closed next Tuesday. Some of us would like to just go and find a way to grill hot dogs all day next week on the 4th, so just be aware of that. But everything else you can peruse in senior bulletin. But today's a great day. Today's a day to worship. Today's a day to be focused on God. No matter what's going on, no matter what's broken, no matter what's working, no matter what we brought to this place, today's just a day to focus on God. And so let us focus on God. Let us give of ourselves to God this morning. And as we do, let us stand and be called to worship with our call to worship and enjoy our voices as we sing, "And Are We Yet Alive?" Psalm 553. I will praise you, Lord, with all my heart.
I will tell of all the marvelous things you have done.
I will be filled with joy because of you.
I will sing praises to your name, O Most High.
Let us sing. Sisters, what is it that you believe?
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended to heaven. And is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the dead.
jar by our children cup, pour for a time of children's clothes. She's gone. It's like the stock market's in the right? God, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your love, for your grace, and for this time to worship you. Lord, we come in our hearts full to worship you, full to desire for you, full of yearning for you, full of a hope to just say yes to you. Lord, we come in praise and glory for you because you have done so much in our lives, so much in our hopes, and so much in everything before us. Lord, we give you thanks and praise. We give you thanks for your love. We give you thanks that you walked amongst us. We give you thanks that you are here. But Lord, we confess that sometimes we don't even take that pause. Just simply right to punish you. We get so busy in our world, we get so busy in our agendas, we get so busy in our lives that sometimes we just don't take that pause to say, what does it mean for us to say yes to you? What does it mean for us to go with you? Forgive us, God, for being so busy that we forget you. Forgive us for just focusing on ourselves. Forgive us for when we forget that you are right here. Help us, Lord, to see you. Help us, Lord, to be focused on you. And Lord, as we focus on you, we ask you to come and pour your holiness, pour your spirit upon our church, that we may be faithful to you. That, Lord, we may say yes to wherever it is you are calling us to go. That we will be bold in our mission, bold in our truth, bold in our hope for you. Help us, God, to be bold in our comfort, in our connections with one another. Help us to not just say we are praying for you, but to put our prayers into action for those who are grieving, for those who are struggling, for those who feel isolated, for those who feel hurt. Lord, may we see you at work. May we have eyes open to your divine presence. May we have ears that can hear you at work in our lives. May we sense you in all that we do. Give you worship, Lord. Lord, come and make yourself known amongst us now. Even now, as we join our voices together, as we pray the prayer you taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As we continue worship, let us do so to the beginning of our tithes and offerings. Thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your... Lord, we ask you to multiply these gifts and use them in the telling of your love and hope to others. Through Christ we pray.
Amen.
Let us remain standing as we sing How Firm a Foundation. Me here on earth, I will also deny before my Father in heaven. I came to bring peace to the earth? I came not to bring peace, but a sword. I've come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. Your enemies will be right in your own household. If you love your father and mother more than you love me, you are not worthy of being mine. Or if you love your son or daughter more than me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you refuse to take up your cross and follow me, you are not worthy of being mine. If you cling to your life, you will lose it. But if you give your life for me, you will find it. This is the word of God for us, the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. Let us pray. Most holy and gracious God, Father, Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your grace, for your hope, and for your love at work amongst us. And Lord, as we enter into this time of deep discipleship and devotion, we ask you to open our hearts and our minds and our ears so that we may be attentive to your word speaking to us. Turn out the distraction of our day and our lives so that we may hear from you. Be willing to follow you. Lord, may I become less so that you may be more in this moment. And may the words of my heart and the meditation of my soul be pleasing to you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Have you ever said yes to something without truly realizing what you have said yes to? Maybe a friend of yours invited you to come over and eat for dinner one night and not realize that they were about ready to get you involved in the greatest new pyramid scheme where you would sell something to one friend and then they would have you sell it to two other friends and so on and so on and so on. I remember right towards the end of my journalism career, I was struggling with whether to stay in journalism or do something else. I was struggling with just being in the newspaper business. I was struggling with where I was, and I wanted to do something better or deeper in my life. Now I realize I was wrestling with a call to ministry, but at that time I was like, oh, no way, no. Nobody wants to see me preach, no way, uh-uh. So I thought that I was going to go work in sports. I've always loved sports, and I hated the fact that I left sports in sports writing to go in the news. One of the biggest mistakes I've ever made, because I gave up free tickets to everything. Let me tell you forget how much you love being a sports writer when you have to pay for a WVU football ticket for the first time. But I found out about this opportunity where I was living outside of Charlotte in Shelby, North Carolina, to go work in sports. And to go work in the sports industry. So I was all excited, like, all right, finally, I'm going to be back in sports. I was making good money, much more than I was making for the newspaper I was working at the time. And so I got an interview. What I did realize was this interview was a car ride around different businesses selling golf coupons. I thought we were going to go market sports and market, like, different events and campaign marketers at different, like, golf tournaments. I was basically a little league softball or little league baseball campaign person that was going around saying, will you send my $19 coupon to get you $5 off at Rowdy's? I said yes to this opportunity to go try this thing out without even realizing it. And the whole time I'm thinking, I hope my boss doesn't realize where I'm at because he doesn't know I'm looking for a new job. I said yes, thinking it was something else, without really wrestling with what it truly was. Does that sound familiar? Does that sound familiar to perhaps our faith in Jesus? That we've said yes to Jesus, we've said yes to loving God without truly wrestling with what it means to say yes? Of what it truly means for us to be in this life with God? I'm going to assume all of us have said yes in some way, but have we truly wrestled with what it means to say yes to God? to just say yes, that I acknowledge you, Jesus. We've taken the time to wrestle with what that means. What it means for our lives and what Jesus is inviting us into. Because if we're going to take this life seriously, if we're going to take this life of being followers of Christ serious, then we need to wrestle with what our yes truly means. And what it means for us in our lives. Jesus forces us to think about this in the midst of a long narrative in a long chapter in chapter 10 of the Gospel of Matthew that we call the missional discourse. If you remember from last week, we talked about how Jesus was with his disciples, he was out in the villages, he was preaching, he was teaching, he was healing, and he said, look, there's a lot of work to do, but there ain't a lot of works. But he's getting ready now to launch them out into doing the work of Christ, to go out and teach and to go out and heal and to go and share God's holy love with people. He's sending them out as witnesses. But in the midst of that, he's giving them some warnings about what this life is going to be like. Prior to our passage that we read this morning, he's telling us, look, I'm going to send you out, but there's going to be some places that you're going to go to that's not going to want anything to do with you, and you just need to dust your shoes off and go home and just have you a cup of coffee and just say, hey, we'll try again tomorrow. That's the Blosser translation. There's going to be places of persecution. There's going to be trials. There's going to be times when you've got to be, you know, like, working and being sly in how you work in order to kind of think through this world. It's going to be tough to go forward. He offers that at the very beginning of the journey for us to think about it. And in the midst of that, all of that, when it's all hard and difficult, he hammers us at the end with saying this: if you're going to go on this journey, you need to acknowledge. If you decide to say yes, if you want to come along, if you want to go about being this part, if you want to say that you love Jesus, then you need to acknowledge Jesus. To acknowledge means to recognize who Jesus is. It goes beyond just simply saying, I love Jesus, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. It goes beyond just merely saying, I've given Jesus my life so I can get out of hell free. It's an acknowledgement that says everything about my life is defined by Christ. That I recognize who Jesus is in my life. That Jesus is the one whom I truly worship. That Jesus is the one who came for me. That Jesus is the source of all truth, all hope, all love. And there is nothing more in my life than I desire than for everything about me to be defined by Christ. His love, his hope, his truth. When we say we acknowledge Jesus, it's much deeper than just a one day come to the altar and say, I love Jesus. It is an everyday commitment to saying, I want Jesus to be at the center of my life. The center, the core of my being, the very essence of who I am, everything about me is defined by Christ and Christ alone. To acknowledge Jesus is to say everything about me is for Jesus. Who I am. How I work, how I vote, how I shout, how I get angry at things, or how I don't get angry at things. Nothing in my life is more important than Jesus. To acknowledge is to put him at his rightful place at the center. But to acknowledge also means that we have to let go. Jesus says in order for us to be a part of this life, to go on this mission, to go on the journey, to be disciples of Christ, that we've got to be willing to let go of our lives. We've got to be willing to lose our life. We've got to be willing to lose everything to gain Christ. Now that's just not something we like here, right? On a Sunday morning at 11:30-ish, right before we go to lunch, we don't like the pastor telling us, if you want to be a part of this life, you've got to be willing to lose everything. What we've been raised and what we've been taught over the last generation in the church is this mindset that if you love Jesus, he's going to give you everything you ever want. You love Jesus, he's going to make you rich. He's going to make your life easy. He's going to take all your problems away. There's going to be no troubles, no struggles. Every day will be holy. Every day will be beautiful. We'll be rich beyond our wildest dreams, with two cars in the garage, a three-floor house, nice picket fence, and kids that never throw anything on the floor. That I'm holding on to. We've been taught the prosperity gospel. Rich is what we desire. Make us happy, God. But it's more than just about having all the blessings and the richness and all those things. It's also about saying, we want Jesus, but we want Jesus to be a part of our life in this one and many. We want to have Jesus, but we still want to be in control of our lives. We want to be in control of how we engage this world. We want to be in control of how we interact with one another. We want to be in control of what we do in this world. We want Jesus, but we want Jesus to be one of many. One of everything. One to where it's fighting for different reflections and interests. When we do that, when we say we want Jesus, but only within the construct of not letting go of all of these other things, what we are doing is perhaps putting on Christ like an adornment, like a watch or a necklace. It's something else we add on to that doesn't really mean much to us because it hasn't been deeply ingrained in our lives. I'm not saying any of those other things aren't important, like how we live, how we shop, how we vote, how we raise our families, how we interact with our society. All of those things have to come with a focus of Christ and Christ alone. To acknowledge Jesus is to say, none of those things are more important than Jesus. The only identifying marker of me, the only thing that I care about in my life is to be known as someone who loves Christ. And that I'm going to seek to follow Christ in all of these other things in my life, and I'm going to make my life and the way I work to be a reflection of my faith. And I'm going to make how I interact in society a reflection of how I live for Christ. I'm going to make how I vote a reflection of how I live for Christ. I'm going to make how I engage my neighbors as a reflection of Christ. And in doing so, we acknowledge Jesus in such a way that Jesus is not just one other thing, to where then we interact with our neighbor by how the world tells us to look and fear, vote by the way our loudest pundits tell us to vote, or raise our families by how our great-great-great-great-grandmother said that that's how you raise them. We do everything in the world with a sense to acknowledge Jesus and to live in an other reference way to where it is all about Christ and nothing else. To acknowledge Jesus is to put him at the center. Not on the side, not as an Adam. Center and let him define everything. And when we do, guess what? We're going to come into conflict. Because when we are living at the center, when we acknowledge Jesus, when we say, you know what, Jesus is the primary thing in my life, and everything else, all these other values and all these other principles and all these other things, well, they're not as important. They're important, but they're not as important. And everything else is going to be defined by that. When we start living for Christ's values and not worldly values, we're going to come into conflict with people. Because we're going to come into conflict with people who will tell us, well, I know you love Jesus, but really, is that really what Jesus would want you to do? Or, hey, you know, you can be a Christian and not be this way. You don't have to be all Christian every day. You know, you can take a break. It's not Sunday after all. And sometimes those places of conflict will come in places where we least expect them. They'll come in our homes. Will we walk in and acknowledge Jesus, and we may have a family member who will come up to us and say, I cannot believe you live like that. You actually believe that stuff? You actually believe that? We'll come into conflict in society that will tell us that our values are of no importance. We'll even come into conflict in the church. What do we do when we face those conflicts? When our faith gets difficult, when it becomes more than just saying, I love Jesus, but when our love of Jesus has to be tested, pruned by fire. When we face the conflicts that will come when we seek to be faithful. It is often in those moments when conflict comes, when challenges arise in our families or in our society, in our churches or in our communities, places of central care, that when we face those challenges, we back off. And say, you know what? Yeah, I can take it. I don't have to love Jesus on Monday through Saturday. I can just love Jesus on Sunday. I don't want to do that. We're so afraid of acknowledging Jesus. And we're so afraid of the conflict that will come in acknowledging Jesus in society that we will hide our faith and hide our acknowledgement of Christ so as not to let it engage in conflict. Because we have this idea to think that Jesus gave us a conflict-free faith. It's something that I've often struggled with myself. I've often told myself, if I was a good pastor, everything would be easy. I heard that. I've often told myself, if I was a good pastor, if I was actually a decent preacher, if I was actually someone that people actually wanted in ministry, nothing would be hard. Everything would come naturally. The sermon would not come out at 10 o'clock on a Saturday night. I would know all the things to do every Sunday. I would know how to deal with every decision, every interest issue, every financial conversation. It would all come easy, because isn't that what faith is supposed to be like? Easy. Faith is hard. And when we face the hardness of our faith lived out in the world, we often back off. When faith in Christ is calling us to go forward in acknowledgement and figure it out along the way. Jesus isn't calling us to abandon our families. He's not calling us to abandon society. He's not calling us to abandon the world. He's calling us to recognize that as we acknowledge Jesus, it will be hard. It will not be easy. There will be moments where we will want to pull our hair out. There will be moments where we will want to question our very sanity. But if we acknowledge Jesus, we will experience more blessings and hope than we'll ever imagine, even when it's hard. When we let go of everything and just acknowledge Jesus, Even when it is hard, even when it is difficult, even when we don't want to say yes, we'll experience the blessings of God's holy presence. And we'll be able to go forward and when it's hard and when it's difficult because we'll know God is there. We'll hear God's whispering voice. We will hear God's presence. And we'll be able to handle all the questions, all the struggles, all the challenges, and all the difficulties that will come. When we are willing to let go and trust in Christ and trust that the road is difficult, but God is there, that is when faith is at its strongest. Faith is not at its strongest when we are just holding on to Jesus on the side. It's at its strongest when we say Jesus is at the center and we hold on to that even in the storms when it is. How good is your yes today? How good is your knowledge of Jesus today? Are you willing to say yes to Jesus even when it's hard? When everyone else is telling you that, it's Sunday, take the day off. Or technology did. That's okay. What do you have to let go of in your life in order to say yes to Jesus? I want you to think about that today as you go off to whatever you have for the rest of the day. As you sit at home in your recliner and you watch the cars go around in circles. Or maybe as you go through the week and you wish it would stop raining. What do you need to let go of in your life in order to be deeply acknowledging Jesus in that? What do you need to let go of so that Jesus is truly at the center of your life? And that center core is strengthened even as you go through challenges and hardships and everything else. May we all have the boldness and the faith say yes to God and acknowledge Jesus as our Lord, even when it is hard to do. Be prayerful. Most holy and gracious God, Father and Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your love and for your hope amongst us. And Lord, as we come, we yearn for you to lead us into a deeper faith, deeper acknowledgement of you, deeper hope of you. Help our yes to be not merely just a word we say, but help it to be deeply ingrained in us so that all that we do gives you honor and glory. Help us to live deep for you. In Christ we pray. Amen. As we conclude our worship, let us stand and sing, "It is well with my soul."
Yeah.
who's been with us for most of the time. Thank you for your willingness to put up with us and me the last few weeks. We thank you so much for being here. As you go forward to go to whatever God has for you this day and this week, go and reflect on the love of Christ. Go and acknowledge Jesus for who he is. And let him be at the center of your life in all things. And go in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.